This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, we have a guest back with us. The last time we talked to him, he told us if certain things happened in Peru, he would come back with the full story. They did happen. It is completely incredible. I want to welcome William Gallison back to Dreamland. If you're a subscriber, missed the earlier show, go to the subscriber section, search on Gallison and G-A-L-I-S-O-N, and you'll find it. It is absolutely fascinating, but you don't need to have listened to that to understand this. It's not a sequel. William Gallison, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's a pleasure.
Great. Well, listen, William, first of all, let's go back to the beginning. You're a professional musician, but you've had a lifelong interest in subjects that we are all interested in. The edge of reality, let's put it that way. Can you tell us a little bit about your bona fides? Why are you here on Dreamland? Where did it all start?
Well, where it started for me was, I think, when I was a very small child, and I think I had a pretty classic abduction experiences when I was between the ages of 2 and 5, because they occurred at a place where I lived at that time. And you may not remember this, Whitley, but we met many years ago on LaGuardia Place, and we spent an afternoon talking, and I told you about some of my experiences, and you said, oh yes, you're a member of the club.
I remember very well. Well, tell us a little bit about those experiences, because folks, in a little while, we're going to Peru. We're going to be talking about those mummies that everybody in the UFO field says are fake. We have got big news, but we want to learn about this guy who is bringing this news to the United States against great opposition first. So tell us about your early experiences.
Well, I don't discuss it. You know, it's not something I talk about very much, but I just had what I thought were dreams from a very, very early age when I was living down in Stuyvesant Town in New York City, and I guess around 1961 and to 63. And I just had this classic experience of being taken out of my bed by little people and taken through the window. And I don't remember much after that, but long before, you know, actually reading your book, Communion, when I was 30 years old, really brought back a flood of things. And I started putting pieces together. Because a lot of what you discussed in that book was very familiar to me, the insect people and other such things, mostly from what I had in dreams. But of course, I had no context for these images and these ideas until I started reading your experiences and experiences like that. And then I said, oh, my goodness, what I thought were dreams were reflecting. But I certainly had what I thought, again, were dreams as a small child of being taken out the window by little people. And it was the bane of my little existence at that time. I did not like them at all.
They were very disturbing to you.
Yes. And of course, my parents would tell me they were dreams. And
I liked my brother. And I knew they weren't dreams. I thought they were
okay,
cool.
I really enjoyed it.
I had a lot of fun with them. I'm sorry you didn't. But, you know, people are different. So,
yes, Steve.
So that's where it started. So, you know, then you read Communion, you realize, wait a minute, something about this is real. He doesn't know what's real about it. I don't know what's real about it, but real is real. And then you go on and you get deeper. And now let's skip ahead because we're really interested in Peru.
We'll skip ahead a number of years. 2016, I was, you know, looking through some UFO related matter on the topics on YouTube, and I see the video of Thierry Jamin, the French archaeologist, and he's showing these disembodied hands and a couple of skulls that were given to him by a tomb robber in Peru.
Now, how do you happen to be looking at this?
You know, it was, you know, when you look at something on YouTube and there's some suggested videos on over on the sidebar, I believe that's what it was.
So it just literally kind of came to you out of the sidebar of YouTube.
Yeah, it caught my eye. I was
probably looking
at something UFO related, and there it was. And I thought,
because here's a guy who's open to this, who's mm-hmm. I know you to be the kind of person who will run after something that you're interested in. You don't sit around. So go ahead.
Well, that's true. And my reaction, like probably everybody else's reaction, was either this guy is pulling my leg, or this is really something, because it's hard verifiable evidence of some non-human being, intelligent being. The hands that he showed in that very first video, one of them had a kind of metal, really one could only call it an implant, on the back of the hand. And so it was clear that these were hands of some kind of technological creature, and so it was very intriguing. These hands also, by the way, had three fingers, and they were about 16 inches long, so there was no question that they were not human.
And
the question was...
You and I know, I mean, I've seen them. I've seen them alive with the three fingers. They do have three fingers.
Yes, and many, many experiences there. I don't have that recollection, but I know that many experiences.
Many do, yeah, exactly. So it's not a big deal to us. I mean, to experiencers, it's what they are, I mean, what they look like.
Well, Whitley, I'm actually curious. In your experience, did you ever see beings with three fingers and no thumb?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I did. I saw some with three fingers and some with four. The ones with three fingers, their fingers were really supple. They were more like snakes. They were many jointed. Let me put it that way.
Well, I'll tell you, it's very interesting you say that. In fact, because we have limited time, I'll cut to the chase.
Oh no, don't worry about it. We'll go on. We'll go over if you need to. Don't worry. But this is an internet show. You know, we're not in any hurry.
Okay, great. What Thierry was given, the first things he was presented by this tomb robber, what they call a jaquero in Spanish, were these hands, several hands, and several skulls. And these skulls were small, about 5 inches long, and not looking like any skull you've ever seen, resembling to some degree the E.T. character from the movie E.T. And then over the next weeks, he started receiving more stuff, including small bodies, about 2 feet tall. And finally, a large body, which was the pièce de résistance, which was a large body the size of a person, about 5'6", if she were to be standing up. But in fact, she was in the mummification pose, which is kind of a fetal position, if you will.
Right.
And that's the pose that many, many mummies found in Peru, are found in, and obviously they don't move once they're mummified in that position. Then the smaller bodies, many of them were just laid out flat as if they were lying on a table. But one of them, in fact, had that same pose. There were in all five bodies, one without a head, the other one's complete, four complete bodies, one small body without a head, and then two loose skulls. And I suppose it's possible that one of those skulls belonged to the body without a head. Then there was Maria, which was a human-sized mummy, entirely intact, very spectacular. And then because she human size, but she only had also three fingers and three toes on each hand and foot. And then a small being, which looked like an infant human, and appeared to have, at first blush, looked like perhaps a infant version of the same species as Maria. But we'll get into that a little bit later. And that one they called Wawita. So they gave each of these beings nicknames, which are important to remember, because each of them has their own characteristics and their own significance in the story.
Okay, we're going to take a little break for our Free Dreamlanders, and Free Dreamlanders, listen carefully, do as you're told. We'll be right back.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So, what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
The Afterlife Revolution is a work of love written across the bridge between the living and the dead, between me and my beloved wife, Anne. You can learn what it means to live across this bridge by reading or listening to the audiobook of The Afterlife Revolution. It's available in paperback, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook on audible.com, amazon.com, audiobooks.com, and wherever audiobooks are sold. We're back talking to William Gallison about the Peru mummies, extremely controversial, debunked by most of the UFO community. You will not hear this story, I don't think, anywhere else. Have you, this Coast open to this? Or
I did an interview with Jimmy Church, not on Coast, but on his Fade to Black show from Peru.
Oh, good. So there's some interest. There. That's good.
Yes, and Jimmy he's very sanguine about it. I can tell he's on board.
Yeah, Jimmy's a cool guy. He's very open-minded, and he's not afraid to go out on the end of the plank with people. And that's kind of what we're doing with this. Because tell us a little bit about the controversies. I mean, the unbelievable rejection of this.
Well, it's really quite. It's a story in itself. Let me just say, the final inventory was shown, where he had these various bodies representing 3 species, I should add. Small beings, about 2 feet tall, many reptilian attributes. The larger mummy and the infant version thereof, which are called Maria and Wawita, respectively. And then these hands, which were clearly from a different species, because although they resembled the hands of Maria, if they had been on a creature the shape of Maria, that creature would have been 9 or 10 feet tall. That's how big these hands are relative to the hands of Maria.
Oh, wow.
But there is a difference, and it's interesting that you mentioned many jointed fingers, because these big hands, this is fascinating. The small creatures, they call them the small grays, although to me they don't resemble grays at all. They have 3 fingers, but each of the fingers has 4 phalanges. I should just say, for people who are not experts in anatomy, that a human hand has, each of our fingers has 3 joints, and those are each joint is called a phalange. And then we have an additional phalange inside the hand, which you can see underneath the skin. So we consider the human hand to have four phalanges. The small creatures have four phalanges on each of their three fingers. The Maria has five phalanges, so an extra joint at the end of the finger, which is significant because it's something that would be virtually impossible to fake.
Well, and this is also interesting to me because I've seen those hands moving, and they really, I can well understand they have additional joints because they're very subtle.
Well, the larger hands,
go ahead,
have six phalanges, Whitley. So if you saw large hands, that really look snake-like because they just could bend all over the place, they could have had, if they're related to these creatures, they could have had as many as six phalanges.
Well, then that would explain it because they really had, their fingers were amazing. Their fingers, they were snake-like. I can actually tell you a very funny story about it, but not now. I will tell the story, folks, at the end of the show after we finish talking to William. So if you want to listen to it, you can then. But
I'd like to add something, Whitley. I traveled with a gentleman I think you're familiar with, Robert Salas, that people who follow the UFO story might know. I contacted Robert when I had been invited to this conference, which we're getting to, the conference in Peru, just a couple weeks ago. And Robert said, Will, I thank you for your invitation, but I've looked into this thing just lightly, and I'm seeing that there's a lot of resistance to it. I'm feeling like it's probably not true. And I said, Robert, do me a favor, please, and just look at the homepage of what's called the Alien Project, which is Cherry's organization's website. By the way, that's the-alien-project.com. And that's really the place you'll find many, many photographs and tremendous evidence for the reality of these beings. So Robert looked at that and he called me back in a few hours and he said, when do we leave? So he was going from California. I was coming from New York, but we met in Peru and we spent a very interesting few days together discussing this phenomenon with the scientists and with Cherry. And with some politicians from Peru, but I'll get to all that. But Robert said that he had an abduction experience, which he's known because he was involved with a fascinating incident with where UFOs shut down the Minuteman missiles that Robert was.
I need to have Robert back on Dreamland. He's a cool guy. I'm going to do that soon, but go ahead.
And Robert said one of the reasons he wanted to come down was when he saw those hands, and he said, I've seen those hands before, just like you said, Whitley. He said, when I had my abduction experience, those were the hands that I saw.
Yeah, it's fascinating because people who've actually been with these beings are not having so much trouble with this story. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think that's true. Getting to the just giving a little context here, what I did 2 weeks ago was I went down to Peru. I should mention that after I saw these videos with Cherry about 2 years ago, I was intrigued. He seemed like a really sincere fellow, and he seemed like he had absolutely nothing to gain from hoaxing something. He was an archaeologist and an explorer who had done a lot of important work with the Ministry of Culture in Peru. He was a respected guy, had no particular interest in ufology, and here he was showing these things. This was not a huckster trying to sell something. And so I contacted him on Facebook, and then I found out he was going to be in France. He lives in Peru, but he was going to be in France. I was doing some recording over there as a musician, so I coordinated so I could go to this little meeting that he was holding to discuss these aliens at a UFO enthusiast club in the south of France. So I met Terry there, and I came away absolutely convinced that he was for real, and the story, at least he was entirely sincere, and he believed that these bodies were real. There was no chicanery going on here. And so we became friends, I'd say, and kept in touch. And because the English-speaking world, there's so much controversy and so much debunking going on, partly because most of the videos that really explain the situation are in either Spanish or French. French because Terry is French, and Spanish because it's taking place in Peru.
Yeah, and Terry was on Dreamland with us, and we had to have a translator. So there's a problem there, because a lot of people in the English-speaking world won't bother with it because it's not in English.
Well, that's absolutely right.
A lot of researchers won't.
Well, there's a number of reasons for that, which we'll get into. I think it's a very interesting topic. I'll just fill in again the context. So this last trip I took to Peru Robert Salas went with me. It was a meeting of all the scientists, or a bunch of the scientists who are involved with the research. And they gathered in Lima, Peru, because there is a congressman named Armando Villanueva, who is the representative from the Cusco region, which is where this research is being done. And he had decided that he proposed a piece of legislation which would protect and preserve these bodies and the sites where they came from, because they were found all together, according to the tomb robber, in a very special and very interesting location. And Congressman Villanueva thought this was important enough to at least look into. And if you're going to look into it, first of all, you have to make the bodies legal and available, so they're no longer contraband, make them available to scientists from around the world to study. And in order to do that, you have to have them protected and kept in a very secure and environmentally controlled facility. So that's what he proposed. And in order to get other congressmen on board, he asked if all the scientists involved with this would come and testify. So it was really a congressional hearing. However, I don't know whether it was significant or not, but Villanueva, as far as I know, was the only congressman present. But the idea was not that this should convince people in real time, but that all of the evidence would be filmed and cataloged, and then it could be made available to the other congressmen, and eventually, hopefully, they will vote to secure and protect these beings. The alternative would be to keep them as being illegal and contraband, because perhaps they are of course, these people are saying they're fake, but on the other hand, they're saying that they came from a tomb, and therefore they're illegal to possess.
Right. So, which is one of the explanations for why they're kept in hiding. But we're going to, free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a little break. Speaking of contraband, listen up. But there's going to be, I think, an ad for the Hitler book in here, In Hitler's House by Jonathan Lane, who is really me, heavily disguised. It's an important book. It should have gotten a mainstream publisher, and it didn't. Don't miss In Hitler's House first. It's really an interesting, good read. It's one of the best novels I've ever written. Second, it's important because it's about dictators and what they mean and how their minds work. And it's a very entertaining novel. Okay, that said, listen up.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So, what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a three-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
This is Whitley Strieber. It's Dreamland. We're back with William Gallison. Can you give us that email, that website address again?
Yes. This is the website of Thierry Jamin. I don't even know how to pronounce his name. Jamin, which is J-A-M-I-N, J-A-M-I-N. Thierry is T-H-I-E-R-R-Y. And his website in regard to this matter is the-alien-project.com. And it has translations in English, French, Spanish, and German.
Now, let's go back a little bit, and we're going to rethread the story here a little bit, because I hope that the congressional hearings in Peru are successful, and the bodies are protected, and therefore there can be some more serious scientific research. And in a little while, folks, we're going to get into the incredible results that have already been found. I mean, this is the real deal here. But what I want to talk about is the whole issue of aliens or not. And this is what I'm getting at is, here they are mummified in Peru in ritual positions. They have obviously been living in that world, in that community. And so should we really call them aliens, or could they be something more like another intelligent species on Earth that is either escaped from the toils of gravity or died out or something? What are we dealing with here?
Really, I think that's the million-dollar question right there, and fascinating to speculate on. Personally, other than the fact that they are non-human intelligent beings that are unknown to us, I don't see much evidence for the fact that they come, for the idea that they come from outer space or from, I shouldn't say there's no evidence, because the DNA, which we'll get into, is very fascinating. They died. There's certainly one thing we can say is that they're not demons. They're not spirits. They were corporeal beings that lived and got sick and died. And I say they got sick because several of these smaller beings have clear indication of bone disease, the kind of bone disease that any animal can accrue in older age. And
the very small ones in older age, isn't that interesting? Because a lot of the ones that are very small are not babies or children, and you know, they're quite startling when you realize you're dealing, and you can see in their faces this is an older person. This is, you know, maybe even like quite old.
We don't know. We don't know what their lifespans are. Maybe they live 30 years. Maybe they live 200 years.
Yeah, but I've seen them face to face that were hardly came up to my knee and were obviously adults.
Well, there you are. That's interesting. Yeah. I'm saying that one would think if they were aliens fresh off of a high-tech spaceship, at least the way we conceive of these things, they would not be suffering from osteoporosis or, arthritis or other things that are found actually in the bones of these beings. That seems like a very terrestrial, very mundane kind of condition to have. And one would think that if you could fly casually between planets, you would be able to cure those painful conditions in your astronauts. So that gives one the impression that they're not quite fresh off the UFO. Now, another possibility is that they crash landed here 20 generations ago or 100 generations ago, or there are other possibilities. But it doesn't seem like they are, you can't imagine them walking around in spacesuits with, with high technology.
Yeah, if they've got diseases of aging, they're buried, ritually buried in a human community, have to think that on some level they were part of that community.
Well, that's absolutely right. Why the coincidence of them being buried in the same ritual position than the humans are? I mean, clearly there's a connection there. Another aspect is there is, as I mentioned, a metallic element in here. There are metal, it's hard to put a word on them, but there are metal accoutrements on these beings, on some of them. There's one which they call Josephina, who's remarkable for a number of reasons. This is one of the small beings. Josephina had three eggs in her abdomen, so clearly not mammalian. And in fact, one of the extraordinary results from the high-definition tomography was that they detected a proto-egg, an egg that was in formation about a millimeter in diameter, which was growing on the uterine wall.
Why does this make me feel so sad? I think to myself, this is a woman. She was there. She was, God knows where she came from or what she was enduring, but she had her body was trying to have babies. That moves
That's
me.
Right.
Go ahead.
Yes, yeah, I agree. And she has on her chest what you might call a breastplate, roughly hourglass shaped metal. Again, if you're going to call it jewelry or device, or we don't know what it is. It could be aesthetic, could be medical. It could have some other function that we can't quite understand at this point. But what is certain is that it's metal and it's applied to the skin. In some way, it's permanently fastened to the skin in some way that's not evident from all the tests they can do. And at one point, it actually, part of this metal piece punctures the skin or goes inside the skin, a small amount, into what would presume would be the heart of this creature. So that gives it a more medical, less aesthetic.
What in the world are we talking about here? Let's get into this thing in a little bit more detail in just a second. Free Dreamlanders, listen up.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From communion to the afterlife revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work, Strieber.com.
Okay, William, first of all, let's repeat this website. It's the-alien-project.com. That's the-alien-project.com. I'm looking at it. It's a very, very interesting site. And, you know, you're going to learn a lot there. But let's go back. This is a metal object, and it enters her heart with
It appears to. It actually, part of it actually goes underneath the skin. The rest of it is either on the outside of the skin or joined in the skin in some way that we don't quite understand, like almost a graft or an implant, if you will. But part of that appears to go under the skin. Somebody suggested maybe it's some kind of a pacemaker. Can apply an electrical current to the heart of this being. But I'll say one thing, Whitley, that you will really appreciate and that not everybody can. And that is, this case is so overflowing with mystery. I mean, you're one of the few people who looks at the UFO phenomenon and says, well, maybe they're aliens, maybe they're not aliens.
Yeah.
I don't know what I know, and I'm not going to say what I don't know.
Yeah.
And in this case is exactly that kind of a thing. Whenever you start to imagine that you have a scenario that accounts for all the evidence here, something else comes up that baffles you.
Yeah, the leap of belief with this. You ruin your whole thing if you do. But you know, just to say this, speaking of implants and stuff, I'm absolutely fascinated by this because you're talking to a guy who has an implant in his ear. I've learned to use it. I use it all the time. I was using it when I was writing this morning, just an hour ago. And it's become part of my life. And I'm the luckiest man in the world to even possess it. But I want to know more about what does the surface – does anyone have any ideas – about what these objects may have been? Has there been any metallurgy done on them or anything?
Yes, in fact, there has. There's been, and that's actually the results are very specifically shown on the website, both the very technical charts where you see the spikes of iron and gold and whatever, you know, and more readable by someone who understands metallurgy and that kind of analysis. But also,
Has there been any isotopic analysis done?
You know what? I don't want to speak out of school. I don't know if there has. I don't think any. If there has, there hasn't been anything remarkable found.
Yeah, there isn't anything on the website.
Yeah, I would imagine that would probably be a different laboratory than one that would just determine the chemical makeup of the metal.
It's a big deal to do this analysis. Yeah, it's very expensive.
And they're not drowning in money, these researchers. So, but one thing I can say, which again speaks to the question of their integration with human society, the one thing that they could say for sure is that in most of the cases, the metal on these beings, the metal behind on the back of one of the big hands, the metal on the breastplate of Josephina, and a couple of other little metal parts, they match exactly with the alloys that were produced by humans at that time. So that just adds another question mark.
So it's probably metal from Earth, and it's stuff that they got here. What the heck is it doing with a wire in it that leads to her heart?
No, the whole thing is just, again, just when you think you might have a handle on it, you lose the handle.
Right.
So that's fascinating to me. And this alloy seems to be gold and silver and iron and I believe nickel. So it's a rather complex alloy. And, you know, alloys are not arbitrary. People just don't throw stuff into a pot. They are made for a certain reason to have certain qualities. Otherwise, they just make it out of gold or silver or whatever. You know, it would be much simpler. But these seem to have the same property of metal objects that have been found in that area, in that time period. And that time period meaning about 1,000 years ago. One thing I didn't mention this time, which I should have, is that these all of these beings were carbon dated. That's a relatively easy and cheap, inexpensive test to do, and there are many labs all over the world that will do it without. If you're trying to get DNA information, you have to say, you have to submit a document saying, where did this DNA come from? And that makes perfect sense so that people aren't just, you know, violating people's privacy by you know, sending a piece of hair or something in and finding one. Yeah, well, find out about
it. We're going to get into the DNA in just a minute. But before we do that, I want your take on the relationship between Peru and the United States.
Well, let me just finish that one thought.
Oh, okay, sure.
So the carbon dating was done at 4 or 5 different labs, and there was absolute correlation between all the labs. All the labs came back with all the same results on every one of the beings. And samples were taken from every part of the being, which is significant. We'll talk about that later. In other words, if they took a piece of a fingernail and they took a piece of, the skull.
But no, talk about it now, because we want to test this part.
They tested those. Well, to me, it speaks of the authenticity of these things.
Yes.
Because if, as the detractors say, that that these are made out of a hodgepodge of animal bones and human parts scavenged from different grave sites and kind of hobbled together to look like a little being, which is patently impossible, but that's their argument, then you would expect there's no way in the world that all those little bits and pieces would have exactly the same carbon-dated age, right? I mean,
right.
If they got one part from a chicken and one part from a dog and one part from a baby, the idea that they all would have died within 25 years of each other is stretching it, wouldn't you say?
And also that they would all be that old, because if you're going to cobble this together, you're surely not going to find chicken bones and dog bones from 1,000 years ago.
Well, that's right, and especially from exactly 1,000 years ago, or exactly 1,025 years ago. That's the margin of error in these carbon dating tests for something of this age is somewhere between 25 and 50 years. So, you know, if they say 1,000, that means maybe it was 950, maybe it was 1,050 years old. But there's no, but all the labs agree that all the parts of all these small beings came from that very time period, and the larger being Maria. Dated again from around 1750 years old. So that's obviously a huge discrepancy. It's about 750 years difference between the larger body and these smaller bodies. But all the smaller bodies seem to be from roughly the same time period.
So the hand then is older, and the other smaller beings are like a family.
The smaller beings seem to be from the same society, you might say, and presumably from the same species. They certainly look the same. They have the same characteristics. The larger being, Maria.
Oh, Maria, I see. I made a mistake. Go ahead.
She's almost, well, the hands is another issue, which I even hesitate to talk about, because that the hands, there was some ambiguity in the results. Maria, as I said, the larger, the human type being with 3 fingers and 3 toes on each hand and foot, was dated at around, let's say, around 1,800 years ago. And the hands, the disembodied hands, which was the first specimens that Terry received, they have been dated, hold on to your hat, they've been dated between 3,000 years and 7,000 years of age.
Wow.
Yeah, and that is not the margin of error in a carbon dating. So there's something going on. Either they were contaminated. Maybe they're 7,000 years old and they were contaminated with something that was 3,000 years old. You know, who knows? That is another mystery. I can't say that, you know, every bow is tied up in this case by any means. But I can say with confidence that the carbon dating of the small creatures and the larger humanoid creature are consistent throughout every lab. The hands, the disembodied hands, which are clearly from another species, they seem to reflect ages between 3,000 and 7,000, even from the same hand. So something is amiss with the dating. It's some kind of contamination or some other. But they seem to be, in any case, much older than the other things. So we're talking about an enormous span of time here.
Were they all found together?
Yes.
They were found together. Yet there's 1,000 years of time or more between some of them.
Possibly 6,000 years of time difference between them. And if you think about, you know, a tomb being used continuously or alternatively, consecutively, I should say, by different cultures over 7,000 years, that would be like us, you know, using an Egyptian tomb to bury our people in. You know, that's how long a span that is. So, yeah, another mystery that boggles the mind.
Now, let's get these datings straight. The smaller beings are about 1,000 years old.
Yes.
So that would take them back to like the 11th century.
11th, 12th century, yes.
In the 11th and 12th centuries, there was a great deal of UFO activity recorded in Japan.
Wow.
And on September the 12th, 1271, there was a priest who was about to be beheaded when an object appeared like a full moon in the sky, and they didn't execute him. And there was all kinds of stuff in that area, in that era. And if you look in Jacques Vallée's book, Passport to Magonia, which is I am reading from now, you find it. So it was a very active period in the world. And that I think needs to be known contextually, that there were other places where there were strange things happening and strange beings being seen.
And the date of the older body, the Maria, corresponds to the same period when it's been determined that those lines, the mysterious lines of Nazca that Jacques Vallée also, I know I wasn't Jacques Vallée so much as von Daniken
the Nazca lines have been fairly well dated, but it's hard because there's no way to carbon date
organic
them.
And, material.
Yeah.
Those seem to correspond to the time when Maria was living. So that's interesting. And she was found in Nazca. So we're not talking about Japan or someplace far away. This was a correlation right in the neighborhood.
I don't see it's too much of a stretch to think that the Nazca lines had something to do with these beings at all.
Well, both are huge mysteries, that's for sure.
Now, let's now go to the DNA.
Okay, Whitley, I will preamble this by saying that I am no expert in DNA. I've tried to learn a bit, but there are many aspects of the DNA question. It's not as simple as one might think. You know, we say that it's been widely said that a human being has 98% identical DNA to a chimpanzee. That's pretty well established, somewhere between 97 and 98% of a DNA's DNA matches with a human's DNA. Because we're two little branches at the very edges of the evolutionary tree. And as you go down those twigs towards the little branch, getting into bigger branches, you know, we all have a common ancestor some millions of years ago. All primates divided from the line of mammals, from the mother, from the bigger limb of mammals, they branched off 70 million years ago, which was 5 million years before the dinosaurs presumably died out. So just to give a little context. But we are, as you go up the tree, when you get into the outer branches of the tree, which represents the species that now exist today, the branches that are near each other, like us and a chimpanzee, share a lot of DNA. And as you go down, back down towards the trunk of the tree, the DNA becomes more different. So that's just the way evolution works. And the DNA that creates any life form, all of us have, every creature on the in the world shares a tremendous amount of DNA, because we all come from the same trunk of this evolutionary tree. And all the processes, like making sugar into energy, cell reproduction, the fundamental things that make life, is a huge part of our DNA. The differences between us and a chimpanzee are so trivial that we are almost the same species. We're very close to being able to reproduce with each other sexually. With that in mind, what I've always heard is that we share 98% with the chimpanzee. We share more or less 90% with a dog, or 94%, because dogs are very much like us. They have heads, they're mammals, they have all the corresponding limbs, etc. As you get further back, when we have our common ancestor with a snake, for example, many millions of years ago, that's when the DNA started to diverge more. So we are very distant from an alligator, for example, or a bird. But how distant? We still share all that fundamental DNA stuff that allows us to live as beings. And this is where I've always heard it said that we share 50% of our DNA with a banana. Right?
Yeah.
So because a banana has to grow, it has to divide cells, it has to turn sugars into energy, it has to process all the basic fundamental processes of life. That's in that bottom, if you will, 50% of our DNA. Now, here's where it gets weird. And this is where I want to caution that I hope I'm speaking correctly. This is my understanding as a non-scientist. My understanding is that we, according to the DNA tests, we share 30% of our DNA with the Maria mummy.
In other words, they're radically different from us.
More different than we are to a banana. Now, how do you get a banana that looks almost identical to us and has, except for the three fingers? I mean, if you saw Maria walking down the street and she had gloves on, she would look like an unusual human being. You wouldn't.
Well, that happened in New York to one of the editors at William Morrow and Company. He encountered two of them in a bookstore, who I knew them, and they walked down the street and right in Manhattan. He saw them walking away. I mean, admittedly, they had hats on and overcoats, but it was winter. But
they were not human.
When you're face to face with the woman on the cover of Communion, and she's not wearing the glasses that you see in the cover, she is. You would think, she looks more human than that, and you would think it's like looking at someone. It's a very disorienting experience, because you think it's a person, but then it obviously isn't at the same time.
Yeah.
So that's sort of where that comes from. I know that experience very well, and as I say, the editor, the Morrow editor, and it's in I think it's discussed in Transformation. He took lie detector tests and everything, and they can walk the streets. In fact,
yeah. And think of just the diversity of human features, just among Homo sapiens sapiens. I mean, you have Australian Aborigines, and and Eskimos with their round faces Nordic people.
Let's go back to this DNA finding, because it's a huge finding. I know a lot about DNA, and this being is not only not human, but is radically different. This is something from a completely different line.
Right. And it's very, my common sense, which is maybe not entirely common, it seems impossible by the laws of convergent evolution. Convergent evolution, meaning you can have a marsupial dog and a mammal dog and they can look very similar to each other, but they are vastly different in terms of their DNA. I mean, vastly in the context of mammals and animals. A mammalian dog is more related, more closely related to a mammalian rat than he is to a marsupial dog.
Yeah,
it looks now, like it, but if you take their DNA, they're going to be more different than the rat and the dog, because the rat and the dog are both mammals, and the marsupials broke off from the mammals long before rats broke off of dogs.
Right?
Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. That, but in this particular case, something sort of like that is present, because you know they have two legs and two arms.
Well, yes,
stand erect, and they use hands.
The small beings, you would say, well, they're just basically have the same body plan as a human being, and that's where the resemblance stops. But Maria could pass as a human being and possibly an attractive human being. If you look at her face, she has very beautiful features in a sense. And to me, this cannot be an example of, to my thinking, it seems to defy the idea that that something with DNA that different could have resembled a human being, having the same number of ribs, having the same number of vertebrae, other things that are just so seemingly arbitrary to have replicated in two species that are living on the same planet. That my sense is that there may be something more of like a hybridization or an effort to genetically or to manipulate the genes so that they present in a morphology that is very human-like. In other words,
it's like a genetic disguise.
There you are. Thank you. And I think that's something, you know, we hear all about. I've been reading this book, Rachel's Eyes. I don't know if you read that book. Fascinating. You know, which is the idea of breeding programs between aliens and humans in order to get the aliens so they can survive on this planet, as humans, and even socialize with humans without being
and interact with us, which they're doing to a much greater extent than we know.
Many people think so, that's for sure.
Yeah.
And maybe this was an early attempt at that, because after all, as you know, there's no reason to think that the UFO phenomenon is a recent thing. If they're doing it now, there's no reason they couldn't have been doing it 1,000 years ago or 10,000 years ago or 1,000,000 years ago, you know, some kind of genetic integration into our, you know, with human beings. Anyway, that's another mystery. In some ways, the Maria mummy, to me, is far more mysterious than the small ones, even though the small ones don't look human for that very reason. If the small ones, again, if I'm getting this metric correctly, if I'm understanding the import, my understanding is that the small beings share 20% of their DNA with humans. And if we're alien, if they had evolved entirely on another planet, one might well think that they have 0% the same DNA sequences as we have, unless the DNA molecule has a propensity to
It may be that we just don't know the answer to that question.
Yeah.
We don't even know the answer to the question whether or not bodies can exist that don't use the DNA format at all. We don't think so, but we've never seen another world, and we've never seen creatures, never examined them in detail, at least not publicly. So until now, and so we can't be sure of anything about that. But it could well be that this is an attempt that failed to create somebody who could live among human beings.
Or succeeded, really. They don't live among human beings as far as we know, but here's something that, you know, that I'm sure is on many people's minds. If these creatures lived 1,000 years ago, we're not talking about a Neanderthal that lived 25,000 years ago or a Homo erectus that lived 100,000 years ago. We're talking about something that was absolutely walking and living and breathing, eating, socializing, only 1,000 years ago, which is historically a moment. And There is no reason to think that these things do not exist today. There's no reason to presume that they're extinct. And in fact, one of the more stunning statements by the Hakero, who calls himself Mario Peruano, that's not his real name, but he's well known to many, many people. And I've spoken to people who have had intimate conversations with him with no pretense, where he seemed to be right, just absolutely speaking his mind. They've told me, and he said to many people, that when he was in the cave, when he was in the tomb where these things were found, which was deadly quiet, of course, because it's underground, he heard the sound of creatures walking and echoing down through the tunnels, because this was part of a huge tunnel system.
This might surprise those of you who have never had been close to the visitors. Those of you who are close to the visitors, it's not going to surprise you at all, I'm sure. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I have no reason to, really no reason at all to believe that these things are extinct. Just that, maybe 5 years from now, they'll find the bodies of ones that died 10 years ago, or they'll find live ones.
They may not find bodies at all, because they're very good at not being visible.
Yes. And especially if they live underground. And the huge eyes on these creatures would indicate that they live in a light, in an environment with much less light than we have.
Yeah.
They would need larger eyes to accommodate, to gather the light.
Which also explains the black eyes, which are, I'm pretty sure, shields, covers for their actual eyes.
You're speaking of the visitors that you're familiar with.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't think there was any evidence of shields or any kind of device on the eyes of these creatures. These eyes of these creatures are closed, and you can see the eyelids, which strangely you very rarely see in the images of the grays. I don't know if you've ever seen a gray blink, or if they do blink. That'd be a question for you, Whitley.
Yeah. Well, I have not noticed blinking, but they must blink if they have eyes.
Unless their eyes are protected so thoroughly by that shielding thing that they don't need to blink. But these creatures certainly did have eyelids, and the eyelids are closed, and you can see the line where the eyelids meet one, the lower and the upper one. You can see that very clearly in all of the skulls of these mummies.
The communion lady wasn't wearing them when Bruce Lee saw her in the bookstore. She had nothing over her eyes, and he said she looked at me with such loathing.
Really?
Yeah.
And I thought you were going to say, okay.
You know, I don't find that. I fell in love with her, frankly.
Well, they may have a different relationship to you, because maybe he wasn't supposed to have seen her.
No, maybe they showed themselves on purpose.
Oh, they did.
She just didn't like him.
Okay.
She didn't like him. I thought he was a very nice guy. But anyway, let's go back to where are we now, William, with all of this?
Well, one thing I want to mention, which I would have preferred to mention before the DNA, because the DNA, again, is mysterious to me and I make presumptions. But what is really cast in stone that you can't argue with is the tomography. What was shown at the conference before the congressman, which we didn't have access to last time you and I spoke, was these high-resolution scans. We all know CAT scans because most of us have been in them for a medical examination. The technology is astonishing. It makes X-rays look like, chalk drawings on a blackboard. Once you have these images, you can basically slice up the body 60 degrees. You can look at various depths into an organ, 1 centimeter, 2 centimeters, whatever you want, by the millimeter or less. They're just astonishingly revealing form of imagery. And that's what they did. They snuck these, with the permission of somebody at the hospital, they took them to the hospital in Cusco, and they had them scanned with the highest resolution CAT scanning, at least, I don't know if it's the highest level available, but it's, professional medical grade CAT scanning. So the images that they have, which you can see on thealienproject.com website, are really stunning, and you can see every little detail of these beings and all the structures within them. So that's, I'll tell you, you know, I think we're going to get to what the detractors are saying. What is the, you know, what is the basis of the debunkers debunking, which has a number of elements. But for me, what makes, and for the other, and for the scientists involved, what makes this so compelling, what makes the authenticity of these things unquestionable, are these images, these medical images. You cannot create something that has muscles and tendons and nerves and blood vessels and organs all connected. if you could make that, you would be God, you know.
Yeah, nobody made these. Yeah. I mean, that argument is over.
And to put a cap on this part of the discussion, Whitley, that is the, I mean, listen, the beings exist. Nobody can deny that. There's photographs. Many people have seen them. And they've been analyzed in every which way. They exist as objects. The question is, do they represent authentic, once living beings? That's the only question. The detractors, which is what they call the debunkers, the detractors say, no, the small bodies are made out of bits and pieces. And I think all one has to consider, if one has any common sense at all, is how do you make a skull? How do you create a skull that belongs to no animal known to man or to science? They have the argument that these skulls were crafted out of a dog skull, where they cut off these bones and they added these bones. They plugged up this hole. They added those holes. They took out these teeth. They put in these things. And that's just simply not what the tomography shows, what the CAT scan shows. It shows an integrated bone structure, which is a skull. And I think that's really all you have to say. And one thing, argument that I've made, Whitley, and I presented on all the skeptical sites, I said, you guys are spending lots of time and lots of money, lots of effort making videos which are criticizing the credentials of these doctors and saying that they're not from great universities and they, you know, they have a bad track record or they made this mistake or that mistake in the past. I said, if you want to prove once and for all to the people that believe in that these beings are authentic, if you want to prove to the world that these are fakes, make one, guys. You're saying
that's what I always say to the people who claim that the crop circles are fakes.
Exactly.
And precisely they say, yes, we make them, but then they won't let you see. And I've been with these people, and I've said to them face to face, show me, let me see. Yeah. And they would not do it. And I don't think that, I think they're liars.
Or they make some crummy facsimile like Doug and Dave did, where they run around with boards on their feet, and they say, here, we made one, and see, that's nothing.
But they do make good crop circles. Don't get me wrong, they can make good crop circles, and they're made occasionally for promotional purposes.
Nvidia
and other places have done them. But they're not like the authentic ones. They're not nearly fundamentally different.
Right. They're fundamentally different because, as far as I understand, the blades of grass or whatever is growing there, when they're made artificially, they are crushed. And when they're made, however the authentic ones are made, I'm sure you will agree, they are bent at the node of the stalk of grass or whatever it is. And they are bent in a way that simply cannot be reproduced by a guy with a board on their feet or any other
human means. Feet. Exactly. The Milk Hill formation, for example, is not reproducible, and neither is the one that was near the radio telescope. We can't do that. But anyway, we don't want to talk about that now. Let's get back to where we are and where we are going. Let's go past the debunkers at this point, because the DNA evidence, the tomography, it's overwhelming. These are not human beings. They are not, probably not originated from this planet at all, because there's a lot of the structural morphology of the bodies is very unfamiliar. Let me put it that way, including.
I will say one thing, another thing about that before we move on. I don't want to forget this. One of the most stunning discoveries of from the tomography was that the bones of these small creatures are hollow, not hollow in the sense that they have in the inside of our bones is
marrow.
Not yet. They're hollow in the sense that they have air pockets in them. And the only creatures that have hollow bones are birds and dinosaurs, specifically theropods. They do have some characteristics which are very similar to those of reptiles and birds. For example, eggs, but reptilian type eggs, and the skin is made of keratin, which is the same as the scales of a lizard or a snake. And they have a bone where we have two clavicles, two collarbones that meet at our sternum. They have one bone, which they call a furcula, and that bone is what you find in birds, chickens, and pigeons. It gives the birds that big chested look when you see them. And dinosaurs also had a furcula, but the only animals that have that structure are dinosaurs, not reptiles, dinosaurs and birds, which descended from the dinosaurs. So there's some very intriguing similarities between the morphology of these guys and the dinosaurs, birds.
So but not us.
But not us at all.
No, not us at all. Well, you know, isn't it fascinating to think that maybe there was an intelligent species that survived and maybe is still with us in some at a level of evolution that is beyond where we are because they are so old. But they are fundamentally of Earth. That, you know, this is really one of the most fascinating shows I've ever done. That thought that it would have any possibility of being true, and this suggests that it might. Wow.
Well, there's no reason, no logical reason. You know, the way people deny, the way scientists deny UFOs, you couldn't go from there to here, or all those kind of arguments. Those are the same arguments which are used to say that no species of dinosaurs could have evolved to be bipedal, sentient, intelligent beings. They were well on their way. Yeah, the velociraptors, for example, that were famous in Jurassic Park, they were very clever animals. They would hunt in packs, and they had all the three fingers and three toes. And the morphology of the hands of these creatures, of the small creatures, is very reminiscent of the velociraptor hands. So, yes, I think that's a real
possibility. Absolutely. Folks, I mean, let's just kind of get our minds around this here. What he's saying, wow, go ahead. Well, wait, let me ask you another question. What about their relationship, their DNA's relationship to the DNA of birds? Has anyone looked at that?
Yes. Again, very, very distant. Yeah, no, they don't seem to be. I mean, if I have this correct, and I hope I do, and if I don't have it correctly, I apologize. I know the numbers are correct, but what exactly the interpretation is, I'm not exactly sure. If I'm correct that the same metric we use to say that we are 50% related to a banana is the same metric we would use to say we are 20% related to these small beings, well, birds are between bananas and us. You understand? Are way between bananas and us. They're much further closer to us than they are towards bananas. So maybe we say, you know, I'm pulling this out of my hat, but let's just say we're 63% related to birds or 72%. These creatures, again, if I'm understanding what I've learned correctly, they are only 19% or 20% similar to us. So,
How similar are they to birds?
Well, again, if a bird is 70, I'm just guessing, if 70-something percent the same as us, and they are 20% the same as us, then then they are very distantly related from birds as well.
Well, we'll have to look at that, because that may or may not be true, actually. If a lot of their DNA is like bird DNA, without getting into the complexities of this now, we need to take a real serious look at the relationship to birds.
I know that their DNA does not match closely with any kind of creature that science has, you know.
So that gets us back to an alien origin, then.
One would think, you know, again, boggles the mind. Yeah,
you know, it's very interesting. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, you know, we talk a lot about hybrid human alien hybrids. Obviously, that's something we've talked about a lot. Now, imagine these creatures, the aliens or whatever they are, the visitors were coming 70 million years ago, and they find a planet not with humans to hybridize with, but theropods to hybridize with. Maybe we should add the possibility that these are hybrids of dinosaurs and aliens.
In other words, they hybridized with a species that could live on Earth long before we even existed. What a wild idea. Man, I'm telling you, folks, if you're a science fiction writer out there, take notes, because you could write one incredible novel about this, and maybe it would have a basis in truth.
Absolutely. There's another, I certainly hope people do. There's another aspect of this which is a little bit less tangible, but if you don't mind me talking about it, it's the more metaphysical, which you're no stranger to.
Yeah, go ahead. We're all ears.
I've spoken to two people, possibly three, but two people for sure, who, both of whom said they had experienced, they were told years ago, not many years ago, but 4 or 5 years ago, that these bodies would be found. And both of these experiences happened, in one case, in what you would call a close encounter, the other case, which you would call an abduction, which I guess are pretty similar. The first one is a fellow named Klaus Honinger, H-O with an umlaut, N-I-N-G-E-R. He's a Swiss paleontologist who lives in Peru. He seems to be a person who shies away from publicity, but he's known as a paleontologist, and he's advocated for the preservation of sites around Nazca to protect fossils and the things that he studies that are there. And he's lived in Peru, like Cherry. He's lived in Peru for 20 years or so. Now, Klaus, who I've chatted with, he says that he met creatures, living beings, technological beings associated with UFOs. His story specifically is that he was not in the Nazca Desert, but I believe in the Paracas Desert or another. I mean, not the Paracas, the Atacama Desert, one of the other South American deserts in that area. He was with his wife and a team of scientists on a paleontological expedition, and they were camping in their tents. Lots of lights appearing all of a sudden deep in the middle of the desert. They get out. The lights are flying all over the place. All of a sudden, there's two creatures standing in front of him, kind of glowing. He can't make out their features terribly well, and they communicate with him, and they tell them, according to him, that they have been on the Earth long, long before human beings have been here, and that they can exist in a corporeal form or in what we would call an extra-dimensional form. In other words, they can transfer between a non-physicality and physicality in our terms.
Which most of us close encounter witnesses have seen face-to-face happen all the time. It's pretty ordinary when you hang out with them.
Yeah, it sounds like it reminded me so much of what you've written about.
Yeah, exactly. I've seen that many times.
So here they are in physical form or semi-physical form telling him this. And he told me, forgive this long sentence, but he told me, Klaus Honinger told me, that they told him that bodies would be found. And another woman I spoke with.
And folks, remember the person who was in the cave hearing the footsteps? That has to do with this ability to be in different levels of reality and right on the edge. Go ahead.
Another woman I met, I happen to sit there. You're no stranger to synchronicities. I sat next to a woman who was also at the congressional hearing. She's I won't mention her name because I don't know if she wants to be identified, but she told me that she's the one who spoke intimately with the tomb robber. But she told me that a few years ago she had a rather traumatic abduction experience, which she didn't tell me much about, but she said it was dramatic and very real. And that she was also told 4 or 5 years ago that bodies would be found. And she said that they told her to prepare herself for this incident because she would be involved in this disclosure. And she had the notion that it's no coincidence that these beings are found now, that these bodies are found now. And again, I don't want to sound messianic or something, or that I'm part, you know, that or that the people that are associated with this case are somehow chosen to be messengers. I don't want to go there. But there does seem to be an element of intention on the part of somebody, no pun intended, somebody, that these bodies would be discovered now. And if you think about it, Whitley, to me, it's a fascinating notion that if you were the others, you know, and again, there may be countless varieties of others, but if you were a particular species that may perhaps cohabitated on the earth with us, and you wanted to be acknowledged and accepted so that eventually you could make contact and guide humanity, for example, away from destroying the planet, which you share. Do you fly over the White House, you know, and beam down and everybody thinks it's Independence Day and runs for their life? Or, you know, do you land in Central Park and freak everybody out? How do you present yourselves to civilization? And it strikes me, this is conjecture, but if I was in that position, I might want to let it be known that some of my ancestors' body, you know, in other words, you find bodies and immediately everybody knows these are not gods. These are mortal beings that can die. We needn't be frightened of them in the sense of, you know, some utterly mysterious creature that we can't understand. They exist here. You bring it out. You bring out the disclosure in the form of dead bodies, which can be analyzed, and you acclimate the human beings to the notion that, yes, these creatures exist. But not only are they mortal and killable, but they're dead. So they don't threaten us in any way. You understand? And then once that's been established and digested by religions, by politicians, by scientists, and by the general public, then you can present yourself. Well, we are the living, we are the living ancestors, descendants of these creatures that you found. And we mean you no harm. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense to me. And, you know, there's been, I mean, I have a lifetime relationship with them and I'm still here. A lot of people do. A lot of your listeners in this show do. And, you know, we live with it. But, you know, it's changing. Recently on Unknown Country, there is a story about how a NASA scientist is saying to SETI that they should take UFOs seriously. And also that thing that went through with the name they chose to make unpronounceable from whatever the hell it was. Yeah. Umuma. They think now was an alien spacecraft, a sail ship that sails on light and something that we could build now. I mean, you just have to have a lot of patience to go to another planet with it because, you know, it doesn't move very quickly in interstellar terms. In any case, some scientists from Harvard think that's what it was. And so we're getting into a situation that's very similar to what the visitors told me would happen, that it is a change of mind that we are in the process of realizing that we are not alone here and haven't been for a long time. And what's happening in Peru and what you're doing is a big, big part of it, because it will come out on this show. And this show is listened to by a lot of people who you'd be surprised would listen to a show like this. And they're going to hear this and they're going to realize this is another step that's being taken, which is great. I mean, and I think you're such a cool guy. It's, you know, it's just, you're the perfect person to be here with this, to bring this.
Well, that's interesting.
You know,
I appreciate that.
An open-minded, smart individual who isn't committed like to a scientific life that where if you publicly talked about this, it would be ruined. I know scientists who would love to talk about this stuff and would love to get on this show with you and read that DNA evidence and get into this, but they can't do it and expect to get grants and so forth and so on.
And tenure and et cetera. Well, you know, I've mentioned to you before that my brother is a very prominent professor at Harvard. And Harvard is considered the, you know, Linda Howe, bless her soul, you know, said, oh, well, when you get somebody from Harvard attesting to the reality of these things, then give me a call. I had a little dispute with Linda about that. But you and I know that somewhere between John Mack's traumatization by the remember John Mack was they tried to get him out of Harvard.
He called me up one morning and said, Whitley, I'm in horrible trouble. They're trying to take away my license to practice and my tenure. And if they do that, I'm destroyed. I'm gonna go jump off a bridge. And I said, John, it's not going to happen. We're not going to let it happen. And eventually he won.
Yeah. And tragically passed away. But how long ago was that? That was in the 1990s.
Yes.
And here we are just a decade later or 2 decades later, possibly. And now Avi Loeb, who's the head of the astronomy department at Harvard, is the guy who's talking about this possible alien sail ship in our solar system. And they just announced that 4 more have been discovered. And God only knows how many more have been discovered that that they're not announcing. So that's a sea change because we're talking about Harvard University, the same old place. My brother, who I adore, cannot talk about this stuff at all. Not that he doesn't want to think about it, because, as I always say, you know, if you're a clergyman in the time of Galileo and he asks you to look through the telescope, it's not in your interest to look.
Right. And, they wouldn't.
Thank you very much.
They actually wouldn't look through Galileo's telescope.
Because there's 2 things that can result from that. You look and you either say, wow, my whole basis of being is wrong. And I'm either going to declare that, I mean, my basis of belief about the Earth being in the center of the universe, et cetera, is wrong. And if I either declare that and get burned at the stake, or I don't declare that and live as a self-aware hypocrite for the rest of my life, spouting stuff I know is not true, and neither of those is an attractive possibility. So the best thing to do is say, thank you, Galileo, but I'll take a pass. And I think that's what most academics do. They simply don't want to even look.
And so the visitors come to people like you and me and a lot of my listeners who are normal, ordinary people without any issues that they have to deal with, so they can talk about it.
Right, exactly.
We can talk about it. We can all talk about it. And we can, as we talk about it, slowly but surely, progress is made in those other fields as well. Now, I started to ask you a question some time ago about Peru's relationship to the United States. And does Peru, is it friendly to the U.S. or more of an independent entity?
You know, I don't know much about that. This was my first trip to Peru. But one thing I would tell you is I went to Brazil a few months ago to play music, and I got turned away at JFK because I didn't have a visa. And I thought, oh, I didn't know that Americans needed a visa to go to Brazil, but you did. So I got one and I left the next day. Peru, you do not need a visa. And to some degree, I think that's revealing about the relationship.
Well, the reason is that you know, the American intelligence community could swoop in on this at any time. And then you're going to get a lot more debunking and.
Well, that's very interesting you say that. I will tell you this. I think the senator, very brave and I think extremely admirable fellow, Villanueva, you know, he's putting his reputation on the line by endorsing this bill. Of course, who could really in their right mind disagree with him? I mean, all he's asking is that they be good, that they're preserved and protected and studied. If they find out they're made out of old shoe leather, then throw them in the dump and it's finished. But if they're real, then Peru becomes an international mecca for scientists. Yeah, and
but
who knows?
What's troubling me is that the U.S. intelligence community could intervene and they could end up with scientists saying they're made out of old shoe leather when they're not.
Yes. Well, that's exactly right. And there are people within the UFO community, and as you know, there are a number of skeletons and a number of closets.
What you're saying is there are people in the UFO community who work with the intelligence community and do not have the best interests of real individuals at heart. That's correct.
Yeah. And I think this is a little bit of a litmus test to some degree. I'm not going to say the people that don't believe in this are spies for the CIA, not by any means. But
some of them are. But
to the degree that they're actively trying to debunk it without actually looking at the evidence and without recourse to common sense, I think one can raise a few red flags. That said, I will say this. Thierry Jamin is like I said, he's an explorer / archaeologist who had no interest in UFOs. Somehow he ended up at the center of this thing. He's got his little institute called the Inkari Institute, including a very badass, if I might say so, security guy who used to head the anti-terrorism team in Peru, serious guy. And, you know, they've been blacklisted in certain ways. They've had funding removed. But thank God they're still with us. And if somebody wanted to truly shut down this story at a very high level, I think it could have been shut down a long time ago. And that gives me some faith that somewhere these people, you know, the real men in black, the real CIA people who absolutely want to shut everything down, are giving this a little bit of a pass. They may be slowing it down. I think the real opposition is more coming from people with more obviously nefarious objectives. I believe, this is my sense, talking about the detractors, that in Peru, there's a tremendous trade of artifacts. That's known for sure. I mean, it's a huge problem. And a lot of people in the government, as in Egypt and any other place where there are ancient treasures, these are being sold. And you have a class of billionaires in Russia and China and the United States who would, you know, buy these things for their own collections. My impression is, from what I've heard, is that there are other bodies. These are not the only ones that have been found. And that these bodies are routinely sold to billionaire collectors. Now, those people in the Peruvian government and their friends in the criminal mafia, or the tomb raider mafia, international trafficking mafia, they have a real, very tangible interest in shutting down this story, because if these beings are recognized as real, I mean, the Russians and the Chinese who buy these things, they know they're real. But if the public at large knew they were real, and the Peruvian government knew they were real, and the Peruvian people knew they were, I mean, let's say, the Peruvian people knew they were real, they would treasure them as a national treasure.
And then the Russians and Chinese, who have been studying them for years, and probably the Americans, would not be able to get them so easily anymore.
Well, I'm not even talking about the people who study them, but the people who just have them to show off to their, you know, $10,000 prostitute girlfriends or whatever they
do. Right, yeah.
That's, I think, who's collecting these things, are these, you know, Saudi and I don't really mean to be.
Well, maybe. There's also, I'm sure that there are scientific organizations collecting them too.
Oh, that I'm sure as well.
I mean, I'm not saying that because I secretly know something, but it just seems like it would be an insane thing for them to overlook. And they, you know, I do know that they're very interested in this whole area.
But I don't think it's the scientists that will buy these bodies for $1 million or $2 million.
No, I mean, fronts like a front for a corporation that works for the CIA that does biological analysis of alien bodies.
Yes, I agree.
They exist. I mean, I know the bodies, the Roswell bodies existed because General Exon told me.
Right.
They told he told other people too that I know. But I didn't get much information. He told some other people great details about the bodies.
And if General Exon saw these bodies, and these are fresh, if slightly mangled bodies from the crash,
yeah,
some of them, I think,
he never said he saw any alive, by the way.
Right, but the story is that they have collected live ones.
There may be, and that's possible. But
so the story in Peru.
But go ahead.
Be,
let's go back to Peru.
The story in Peru. These mummies might be somewhat trivial to these guys because they have fresh, supple, you know, somewhat recently deceased bodies or even live aliens to study. But the fact is, they don't want as you well understand. The government entities or the paragovernmental entities that study these things, they want them for themselves. They do not want scientists from Harvard and Columbia and Stanford and you know, universities around the world.
That should change.
Yes, of course. My goodness. And that's
I can understand them wanting materials that might be turned into weapons and stuff and keeping that secret, but not these bodies. There's no point in it.
Yes. So that's another reason why I think it's possible that these, that there's an effort afoot by the creatures themselves to introduce themselves to the general public in a way that's not devastatingly threatening to the CIA. The CIA, I mean, for all their evil intent, part of their intent is that they don't want to freak out the human race, and they don't want us to suddenly believe that we're vulnerable to an attack from something that they cannot protect us against. That's one of the motivations. And again, presenting us with dead, mortal, dried up creatures that we can study is a safe and comforting way to introduce us to the notion that, yes, non-human intelligences exist, that we are not alone. And once that door is opened, I'm sure there's a lot of people in the CIA who would like to see the secret unveiled so that they don't have to live a life of duplicity.
Well, yeah, and it's so complicated. I mean, I'm an outsider. I'm not pretending to have any secret information or secret knowledge, but it must be very complicated on the inside because I'm sure they have elements among the visitors that don't want themselves to be exposed. And
well, that's clear, because if the visitors wanted themselves exposed, they would just fly over New York City.
Right. They want us to find them on our own terms, and they will hide. Yes. They will not, they're not going to land on the White House lawn, but if we figured out how to steal a flying saucer and put it on the White House lawn, that would be fine.
Right. Or
but
if we
have to do it on our own.
Hey. Right.
And it has to come up from below, from our level, not from on high, from the president and so forth. It has to come from the ordinary people fighting and doing this and keeping the faith and making sure that we as a community of human beings, as a community of people, go from the level of, oh my God, they're aliens, to they're just aliens.
Yes. There are space brothers.
Well, not necessarily our space brothers. Let's be careful here.
Oh, okay.
They might not be brothers. They might really not like us. We don't know that. And there might be probably will be a whole lot of different attitudes towards us.
Yes, of course. Right. But that they are, yeah, okay, I understand. But they don't want us to have the notion. Clearly, they don't want us to freak out and everybody committing jumping off of bridges and because if they did want that, they would just show up, and they don't.
They would, and they can show up. I know a lady who was lying in bed. She's a psychiatrist, and she's Swedish, and she's smoking a pipe. It lived in New York, and suddenly the closet door flew open, and a whole bunch of these beings, like the small ones, came kind of dancing out in a conga line, went across her bedroom, and walked out through the wall into West End Avenue on the seventh or eighth floor. And the next thing she knew, her bed was on fire because she gasped, and all the fire from the pipe had gone out of her bed.
Well,
it's a very funny story, but it is. It is going to be weird when this happens. It's not going to be, you know, it's not going to necessarily be like something we might dream up and put in a science fiction movie. It's going to be its own thing.
And what a brilliant way, I mean, whether or not it's the truth, what a brilliant plan it would be to have some Hakiro, some tomb robber, find these bodies, present them. I mean, it just seems like a perfect way to introduce them to the people of the planet. I had an interesting thought the other day. I was thinking, if you were in Scotland, if you lived in Scotland and a baby Loch Ness monster washed up, dead one washed up on the shore, or even they found a mummified one or something like that, that being would be beloved. You understand? It would become a mascot for all of Scotland. There would be t-shirts and movies and songs written about it, and it would become a bit of a cultural pride and joy. And scientists would come over from all over the world to find this, whatever it is, you know, ancient dinosaur-like creature, whatever. I'm thinking if in Peru, these things, or let's say if they found something like a leprechaun in Ireland, again, the same thing would happen. If Peru could own these creatures as their heritage, and become the center of scientific, you know, interest from around the world, it could be very, very good for Peru. And I'm hoping that maybe this is a good note to leave this on. I'm hoping that kind of attitude could be engendered by this thing. Sadly, I was going to mention this before, but after this conference, apparently 5 of the leading television news commentary shows in Peru ridiculed this, as you would expect, right? And you know, called Villanueva an idiot, and you know, the scientists are obviously not serious, otherwise they wouldn't be involved, you know, and the whole business. And that's unfortunate, but I think I'm hoping it can be overcome.
Well, it's going to be hard to overcome it, because if they're not open to it there, then it's going to be hard. But, you know, we're here, we're open to it, and maybe in time this story will become much more part of the mainstream reality, that they're here, they've been here a long time, we don't know where they're from or exactly what they are, but we know a few things about them, and they're important things, like they don't have to be in the physical world. And that alone is huge, because it means that maybe we don't either. We just don't know how yet.
Well, there's a very popular human being who apparently could live in both worlds, and that was Jesus, right? Who, according to the story at least, could exist in the corporeal or the transmogrified.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm a student of the Shroud of Turin. I was among the Anne and I were among the contributors to the first studies of the Shroud of Turin, the financial contributors. And I've been following that for a long time. And in my book, The Afterlife Revolution, I kind of come up to date with it. And it's not explainable. The stuff you see on the internet about it being from the Middle Ages, and it's a complete cock and bull story. It's not true.
So another similar situation where people call something a fake and they cite phony data, and the very same playbook.
Yeah. Well, okay. Thank you, William Gallison, for being with us. Thank you for going down to Peru and doing it and, you know, putting yourself where I wish I had been able to go with you, but my knee was killing me, as I told you at the time, and I couldn't do it. Yeah. I was going to have an operation, but then something happened and the knee pain went away. Now I don't need the surgery, but it's too late for me to go.
Okay.
Next time,
I want to thank you, Whitley, because it takes, you know, even among the group of outcasts that we are in already, you know, being interested and vocal about our interest in UFOs and related subjects, in today's climate with this particular story, you, and this I've told this to many people, Whitley Strieber doesn't give a hoot about what people say about him. And he goes for the truth wherever it lies. And I really admire it, and I'm very grateful.
Okay, William, thanks so much for being with us. And folks, now I'm going to tell you my story about the hands, and it's a cute story. You'll enjoy it. But William Gallison, thank you very much for being with us. And to go to learn more about this, go to thealienproject.com. That's the-alien-project.com. The story goes on. Thank you, William.
Thank you, Willie.
Okay, this is a story that took place in my cabin years and years ago when we brought somebody up to the cabin who the lady visitor on the cover of Communion did not approve of. And this was a person, the reason she didn't approve of him was that he had done something incredibly stupid in his childhood. He was a nice guy. He'd stuck his tongue in a light socket, and he had a big scar on his mouth where this had blown out his mouth. So we go to bed that night, and he was a kind of wild guy. He did a lot of really wild things. He was a bit of a daredevil. She did not like me and Annie and being involved with someone like that. So what happened was this. All night, she kept showing up at the bedside and feeding me these images of his face with smoke coming out of the side of his mouth and stuff. And seeing him in dangerous positions, like in situations like in jalopy taxi cabs, going at breakneck speed down Broadway and stuff like that. Meanwhile, and this is where the hands come in. Remember what we talked about with the hands earlier, with the snake-like fingers. She was opening his bedroom door a crack and sticking those three long fingers in the bedroom door and tapping with those her scary nails on the door and scraping them up and down the door. And the fingers were like snakes, and he was waking up and seeing this. He never came back. In fact, he was very sweet. He said, look, frankly, I'm going to go home. I'm not really up. I'm not ready for this, is what he said. And so he pulled out. And after that, Annie said, I have a feeling we're not ever going to see him again. I said, Annie, I think that's right. She doesn't like him. And Annie said, well, maybe she knows more than we do about him. And we haven't kept up. And that's the end of the story. But that was what it was like living with her. Of course, I fell in love with her. She was a wonderful woman. And she was really scary and really, really powerful. And, you know, sort of a dominatrix, but not sexually. She's just so powerful. She's exuding this incredible, powerful energy. Anne thought she was really cool. I mean, she liked that type of feminine energy in the house. And I guess I did too. And I miss those days a lot. I miss her. I haven't seen her in years, and I'd love to see her again in this life and in the physical. It would be such a blessing. But in any case, that's the story. And have a wonderful Christmas season, folks. I love you all very much. You have no idea how deep that goes and how real it is. And it is like a wire, like it, that one that was in that being's heart in Peru between my heart and every single one of your hearts. God bless you.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Anne Strieber Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.